The next match you get is Yellow Dog versus Johnny B. Bad. And this is a funny one for me because both of these people are capable of having a really good match. Mm. And if you said to me, there's a Brian Pillman versus Johnny B. Bad match, you'd go, that is probably going to be quite the sleeper hit.
Yeah.
It's an amazingly weird thing that by putting Brian Pillman in that Yellow Dog mask, it somehow killed all the excitement about him. Just a really weird one. From the Kennel Club. Which is like saying he's from Crufts.
Yes, nice, yeah.
And along with Man's Best Friend, which is a dog.
An actual dog.
Jim Ross goes, a yellow dog.
Thank you, Jim.
It's a Labrador.
It's a good, yeah.
Brian Pillman is under a mask because he has a Loser Leaves WCW match with Barry Windham. And he comes back wearing a mask. Yeah. And this is something that Dusty Rhodes used to do. So he would lose a, you know, Loser Leaves Florida match.
Yeah.
And he would then return under a mask as the Midnight Rider. And what this was because Dusty Rhodes is so distinctive, it was obvious who it was.
Yeah.
And what it would be was the commentators would sort of play up the not 100% sure this is or isn't Dusty Rhodes, whereas his opponent would be like, this is definitely Dusty Rhodes and he shouldn't be here. And the Midnight Rider would be going, there's no way you can prove that.
There's no way.
No way at all.
There's no way.
But it's also the fact that Brian Pillman does a really, really poor job of actually selling anything to do with this mask sort of business. So really, these matches should revolve around, well, apart from anything else, it should be someone you're in a feud with.
Yeah.
You don't come back under your mask to just have a normal career like you would anyway. You come back to get revenge on the person who put you out of the business. Mm. What he should be doing is spending his whole time almost having his mask ripped off or holding his mask on in circumstances that it looked like it was going to come off. It's so simple. What happens in this match is, of course, he just has a normal match and it's fine. But there is a bit where Johnny B. Bad starts to take his mask off.
Yeah.
So Johnny B. Bad, they're actually doing the right thing.
Yeah.
They all look round. Johnny B. Bad is like, oh, I'm gonna take it. And it's fucking crickets out there. So I was watching that and thinking, oh, I was really criticising this for not doing the sort of basics. And then when they do it, it just died on its arse.
Right,
It'd be far better to feature Eric Bischoff going into, in his debut, Missy Hyatt's dressing room, where he can then...
just look at a lady in the
having a shower.
Yeah.
Different times, Pete. Different times.
Not that different.
Not that different, no.
Different,
you probably wouldn't put it on a pay-per-view these days, but I'm sure it still goes on.
Yeah.
Well, here are things. Obviously, she's in the locker room. I hear noises.
Oh. Oh, I love this job. Somebody's got to do it, right?
It's because he's horny, Mark. Do you not understand? He wanted to do it because he was horny. He wanted to fuck someone or see some boobs.
There is the whole thing about him going, oh, I'm the luckiest guy in the world. And it's just, it's sort of gross and creepy. And not in a sort of like comic way. So Missy Hyatt screams, get out, get out, get out.
Mm.
And Eric Bischoff, he just turns and he sort of goes, timing is everything and mine is obviously very bad. I think that's sort of like timing.
Yeah.
Timing is what you do when you don't have like charisma or charm or a friendship sort of button.
Yeah.
And I think timing is what fucking railway rapists rely on. Just good timing there.
Yeah.
Repulsive man.
Horrible.
Awful.
Rough.
Let's get to my favourite match
the
entire show.
Wow.
Not for what happens in the ring, Pete,
okay,
but for the calibre of person it involves. This is Big Josh versus Black Blood in a lumberjack match. Basically, what you have here with Matt Bourne and Black Blood is you have two of wrestling's most unsavoury men in one match.
Right.
If you add on from the lumberjacks, Dick Murdoch and Dick Slater, who was charged later in his life with attempted murder.
Wow.
You have pretty much, like, not just the sort of worst group of wrestlers you can have, but I would say one of the worst groups of men that ever congregated in the 90s. Tony Schiavone, he says at one point, we got some bad guys around the ringside area, and it's just an odd thing where I sort of go, it's funny you sort of, like, mention the word bad guys, you know, because they are specifically bad, wrong, nasty,
nasty,
frightening
men.
Black Blood is Billy Jack Haynes. Billy Jack Haynes, he looks like a cross between Peter Sutcliffe and Jeff Capes. Hunks. And it's sort of fitting that he looks a bit like Peter Sutcliffe because there are an awful lot of stories involving murders about Billy Jack Haynes.
Right.
So there was a general word on the street that was, do not make Billy Jack mad. He was a very soft-spoken guy, but he had very little charisma. Sort of really bad combination. I have no charisma, but I am legitimately violent. A really, really sort of odd sort of combination. He was trained by Stu Hart in the Hart Dungeon in the early 80s. When
we're
Billy
all the
Jack
best
Haynes,
men. We're all the best men are made. Yeah.
He was described at the time in the 80s as he was huge, he was good looking, and he was muscular.
Right.
And that would get you pretty much to the top of the card during the 80s in wrestling. Billy Jack's main gimmick, which he would take through pretty much his biggest sort of part of his career in the WWF, was he wore a hat. he had a black hat that had a band on it, and
right.
that was it. That,
yeah.
that was just the
That's
thing.
All you need.
Now, he refers to that hat as being a very good gimmick. he felt. It was the centre of another sort of like classic Billy Jack Haynes story, when he was in Florida and he came back from his match to find that someone had taken his hat. And they had filled it in the toilet full of shit.
Right.
He blamed Barry Windham and Mike Rotundo. They had been WWF tag team champions fairly recently. Windham said to him, "Come on, man, you can't take a rib." And Billy Jack Haynes said, "You have got 2 seconds to defend yourself." he then knocked Barry Windham out. He smashed his head into the sink repeatedly. And Mike Rotundo tried to drag Billy Jack Haynes off. As Billy Jack Haynes turned around, Mike Rotundo, better known as IRS, ran out, in the words of Billy Jack Haynes, like a chicken shit. So again, do not make Billy Jack mad.
No.
Those are words, no. That's the sentence that we can remember.
He gave you 2 seconds.
If you're going to have a tattoo done, it's as good as any, a good a piece of advice just to have, do not make Billy Jack mad, but somewhere visible on your body.
I think two seconds is a lot of time to do something.
I think it would have felt like a long 2 seconds.
Yeah.
I think I'd have done is killed him. I think there is no other way out. I think
I would have Sonic boomed him. I would have punched him so hard I Sonic boomed him.
I'd have just grabbed his head and I'd have wrenched it up and hopefully just pulled everything out. It's the only way I
get
can
lucky,
see.
Get lucky, get the little kind of death grip that kills a man.
Get lucky once and you have got a free pass for life.
Yes.
No one's going
to mess
around
with you.
With you.
Just pulled a guy's head off like fucking Sub-Zero or something.
And all of the spine came out with it.
He flopped it around.
Oh, sorry. Do you want to have a go at me about something? No, I didn't fucking think so. And he ends up in the early 90s. He has a surprisingly good run in the USWA, which was the promotion pretty much run by Jerry Lawler. And he gave one of his rare good promos here, which is slightly only ruined by the fact he's not got quite the right modulation in his voice.
Right.
So quite a lot of what he says goes a bit higher than you'd want if you were trying to be intimidating.
I'm not here to win friends and influence people. This is the toughest sport in the world, pro wrestling. And I'm not out to hurt anybody at all. I'm out to break their neck and take them out of here. Because that's what I come here for. Punk is for the unified title. And this week, I'm taking that home too. Everybody else can get my butt.
That was genuinely frightening because you've told him how frightening he is and he screams because he's unhinged.
Yeah.
And wow.
He is one of the single shadiest people outside of the ring. So he claims that during his time in the WWF, he was actually a major cocaine dealer who was working with the Medellin cartel that was, I think, Pablo Escobar's joint. It gets better. In 2018... Billy Jack Haynes sensationally admitted witnessing the 1987 murder of two teen boys, and he claimed that senior US politicians covered it up to hide their links with cocaine trafficking. This murder was in August 1987, at a time when Billy Jack Haynes was working for the WWF. In August 1987, at 4 a.m, the bodies of 16-year-old Don Henry and 17-year-old Kevin Ives were hit by a cargo train in Alexander, Arkansas, as they lay on the tracks. The train driver had attempted to stop the train. He blew the horn. There was no response. So the police arrive on the scene. The train driver says, "I think as I was approaching those bodies, they were wrapped in a green tarpaulin," and they couldn't find a tarpaulin anywhere on the scene.
Right.
The boys had apparently left their houses to go hunting. The deaths were initially ruled as an accident, They were exhumed the following year, 1988, and it was ruled that homicide was more likely.
Right.
So 30 years later, in 2018, Billy Jack Haynes came forward and said, August 23rd, 1987, I was on the railroad tracks in Alexander, Arkansas, and I witnessed everything that happened to those two young boys on the tracks. He says that the two were murdered after stumbling upon a drug deal that involved corrupt cops and high-level US politicians. Billy Jack Haynes said, in August of 87, I was contacted by the Arkansas criminal politician and was asked if I could provide muscle for an Arkansas drug drop. Who do you think that Arkansas politician who contacted Billy Jack Haynes was?
Arkansas. Was it Ken?
It's better than that.
Right.
I've got a little surprise for you, Pete. Right. Here's Billy Jack Haynes.
The next time I flew down, they wanted me to come down on my own, meet Barry Scheel, and Barry Scheel had a politician that he wanted me to meet. When a man walked in, with it looked like two bodyguards who walked ahead and set up about 20 feet ahead of us. And the man was Bill Clinton. I didn't know who he was.
God, Lord.
But it was a governor.
So basically, Billy Jack Haynes says what happened is he left Detroit, where he'd been wrestling King Kong Bundy for the WWF, and he headed south to Arkansas.
To work muscle for Bill Clinton and the Medellin cartel.
That's right. Now, okay. Bill Clinton wanted to make sure that nothing was going to be stolen when the drugs were dropped off at this Arkansas
look airport. If you are a politician, you are a details person. You want to know. You want to be everywhere.
Basically, Billy Jack Haynes is brought in because they say, we want some muscle to work out. If anyone tries to steal our drugs, we want you to help us out.
Yeah, okay.
This is, I mean, yes, they've got the whole of the local law enforcement involved in this as well. But it's important to bring in a mid-level WWF wrestler in case anything goes down.
Yeah.
I mean, this all checks out.
Right? Look, if you cannot trust the testimony of a intoxicated bump enthusiast of both kinds.
Yes, very true.
My job was to... only was to tape. He got me a VHS tape recorder and two tapes. I put one tape in my suit. I had a suit on and jacket. Film the drop and see who's stealing these drops. If we do catch them, we'll put them in the van, drive them back, cuff them up. It'd be my job at that time to beat both of them to death. At a said location away from the governor's mansion.
Good grief.
Wow. It's worth saying, this is all from an interview that he gave with someone who does not, even when he's like, can you tell us a bit how you got in contact with Clinton? He's not going, I mean, this is bullshit.
No.
He's going, I'm
trying to... Even down
to...
a phone line, I know you're going to kill me regardless. Whatever I do here.
So his job is to beat them to death. That's basically... If he, while he's video recording with his... He's wearing a suit.
Yeah.
Make that clear. Wearing a suit.
So the video recording goes into a suit.
Yep. One of the tapes goes in. Yep.
I mean, how big is this suit?
How big is that tape recorder?
For me... I look at that and I sort of go, he sounds like a man who's fantasizing about owning a suit. Isn't he? He just sounds like a man who's like, well, I presume they would. Why else would you wear it?
I love the thing where he goes, what I want you to do is video it. And what I also want you to do is note if anyone takes anything.
Yeah.
And then moving on from that as part of the job, if it does turn out that someone is taking them, I will need you to go to a set location.
Yes.
And beat them to death.
Yeah, away from the governor's mansion, Mark.
Yeah, away from the governor's mansion.
Near the governor's mansion. No. Don't do that. If you can still hear my saxophone, you're too close.
So Billy Jack Haynes says that, yes, these two boys were walking through the woods and they stumbled upon them while they were all out there. No one has ever been charged with these killings. It's one of
absolutely
those...
dreadful.
Awful. Killings, but one of those killings as well where someone like Billy Jack Haynes is able to weave a little web of fantasy that people begin clinging to. So he certainly has been involved in some sort of awareness raising campaign with, I believe, one of the parents of one of the boys.
Right.
So she has very much grasped onto that, which is sort of even fucking worse if it is a load of old horseshit. You know, when you see, like, when you're, like, I don't know, in a pub or something, and there's one bloke there who is absolutely gone batshit on drink, and he's just ranting and raving. And when they sort of go, right, you out, there's a slight bit where you go, sort of enjoying this. You know, I didn't like it when he came near.
Yeah.
But sitting on the other side, I was like, oh.
When he got sleepy and was just mumbling, that was more enjoyable because when he was started wheeling around, he thought he was going to push the fruity machine on me.
It's always that thing, I'm just waiting for him to push over a barmaid so someone has a legitimate reason to lamp him. And then when he goes out, I'm like, oh, I didn't get to see none of that. And I'm slightly watching Billy Jack Haynes. You watch him through the screen, you go, oh, but you smell really metal. The metal of lies and old drug use.
Yeah.
Oh.
Lovely.
The match itself is perfectly workmanlike. Yeah. Why would you ever want to watch it?
No.
It is just one beautiful little Dusty Rhodes cherry on top, which is that Black Blood gets hit by one of the lumberjacks in the leg. And the person who does that, which leads to Black Blood losing the match, of course, is Dustin Rhodes.
Of course.
He's won his elimination match.
No, now he gets back out there, son.
He's just taking on everyone left, right, and centre.
Part of it.
I bet Billy Jack, there was a moment where he looked round and he thought, I'm going to get another green top.
Oh, Billy Jack.
El Gigante versus One Man Gang.
He's back, the big guy.
They come down, One Man Gang and Kevin Sullivan, and they are wearing eye makeup and they've got a studded belt, and Kevin Sullivan is leading out One Man Gang on this leash, and he's got no top on.
Yeah.
And they do look like two sort of homosexual caricatures that have been locked in a leather bar since the late 80s, and someone has just suddenly gone, shit, that's been shut for 4 years.
And they're still fabulous.
They've opened the door, and these two are just like, to work! You know? I weirdly fell in love with the two of them because they're so bad in this, to be honest. Mm. It's One Man Gang, who is the former Akeem. So Akeem in the WWF, where he was playing the fake African partner of the Big Boss Man in the Twin Towers. A whole lot of stuff there that doesn't sound
great.
It wouldn't fly.
No. And it's like it's an algorithmic kind
One
of
Man Gang.
This is a terrible algorithm.
It really is.
It's brought up three aspects we didn't need.
Yeah. Siri, can you put together the three worst things I could do as a wrestler in 2020? Be a white man portraying a black man, be in a tag team called the Twin Towers.
Yeah.
And just be Akeem. I mean, he was shit. El Gigante then comes out in one of the great entrances of all time. He is a very, very tall man, and he comes out with four people of restricted height.
Yes.
Magic.
I mean, but then they go and run over to his opponent.
Yeah.
Also making him very large as well.
Yes.
So it's like, just keep him with you.
The thing I love about the guys who come in who are short, what's the word we should use now?
Say again?
What do you use for people who have restricted growth?
They've got dwarfism. I think those guys had dwarfism, I think.
Am I allowed to call them dwarves?
Yes, I think you can.
Okay.
Right. Call them people first.
I know.
Call them Dave first, if you know their name.
They're also wrestlers, Pete. They're not real humans. So they come out. One of them, I think three of them look like they've tried to be El Gigante. So they're wearing shorts and they've had the head shave.
Yes.
And one of them is not having any part of it.
He's got a booking.
He's slightly dressed as Kevin Sullivan, but he's left a t-shirt on. He's like, I'm not taking my t-shirt. And it says on the back, Little Louie, you've got to protect the brand.
Right.
Out comes Little Louie. Now, Little Louie. Oh.
It's the Raw General Manager.
It says we can use the word dwarf.
Thanks, mate. You've always got our back.
That was from Jim Davidson. Thanks, Jim. Appreciate it, son.
Always on the internet, Jim. Why is he on YouTube now? Why has he come back?
From Argentina at 7 feet, 7 inches. He weighs 454 pounds.
That is tall. I know
Imagine
some people.
Buildings. Who, like, I understand doorways, but buildings not being able to hold you.
I do know some. I know a guy who was 6'8".
Yeah.
And that is
giant.
It is mad, isn't it? Being in a world that is not made for you.
Talk to the guys who aren't very big who came out with El Gigante.
Yeah.
I mean, both sides of the spectrum, I suppose.
Really? I mean, what they bring out, instead of sort of going, wow, isn't he tall? You just go, these are five of the least thought of people in the building.
Yes, exactly, yeah. This building.
Welcome.
This
tableau of sorrow.
Yeah.
I've always felt that because, like, even when I was a kid, you know, I was much bigger than the other kids.
Mm.
And when you go to, like, fucking sailing centres on, like, a school summer trip,
right,
that sort of thing. So you go camping for a week.
You
go windsurfing, that sort of thing. And they'd always just have, like, a bag full of wetsuits.
Mm.
And they'd go, right, let's get you some. Yep, that one's for you. That one will fit you.
Yeah.
And they'd look at me and they'd just go, yep, I think this one will work. And it'd always come over and I'd just have it in my hand just going, I mean, there's absolutely, I can tell just from the weight of it that that is not going to go over me. Imagine being El Gigante.
Yeah.
Everything. And it's not like a fucking wetsuit for a 6-hour Portsmouth windsurf that you're going to do very, very badly.
Well, he got his suit.
It's things like going.
And it had pubes drawn on it.
Yeah. Can I have a pair of shoes?
Yeah. Yes, you know? Exactly. Yeah.
What? We want them made to measure? Cram into these ones. What's wrong with plastic bags? You know? People and humans.
Oh, no.
He does try hard, El Gigante, in this, and it does make me sort of slightly warm to him. He's beginning to sort of do lots of whoa with his hands, and he's trying. It just doesn't come natural. He just must think, what is this strange? It'd be a bit like if you know, you were abducted and taken to Bulgaria, and you were made to be in a
basketball
play
team.
A play about like a folklore bear, you know, and they go, you come out and you go, whoa, and people go, yeah, I like this, and you go, I don't know why they like it. I'm doing what they're telling me, and it does work, but I just don't understand any of it, you know? Now what will the bear have for its tea? I will have yogurt. They're really laughing.
Is it that rice pudding?
Son of him, he's handing. That's powder.
Let's go to the other side of the world.
Whoa.
For a Russian chain match between Sting and Nikita Koloff.
Yeah. Jim Ross, before this match, he goes, Lex Luger, sorry, I mean Sting, he's just checked out. He's just absolutely checked out.
Here's a close look at the feud between Sting and Nikita Koloff.
There's a little bit in the package where Sting holds up a boy. And the boy is, he's definitely on the other side of Too Old to Hold.
Too Old to Hold is an amazing album title for you.
But he's holding up this child, and then he has the line, he says, this makes me feel excited, and this makes me feel good.
Pick him up like that, I mean, you know, this right here gets me excited and makes me feel good. High five, man, yeah.
And I'm like, 1991, you must have watched that back and gone, this looks fucking weird. It's just...
this makes me feel good.
It's, I am so uncomfortable. And then Nikita Koloff comes out and he starts threatening the child.
Yeah.
And I was like, I am less freaked out by the man threatening screaming the child than the man who was... holding the boy who is, hey, the boy is too big.
I don't think that his sexy mum is his mum.
No, I don't.
She's a model.
No, completely. They are two actors in what I imagine was only role. Don't know, not sure. But this is two guys who are working really, really hard.
Mm.
And the match is one of the most boring matches I've ever seen. It's just so dull. They don't really use the chain in the match at all.
It's mainly testicle jokes. It's mainly used for testicle jokes.
As soon as you go, you don't have to wrestle. They just go, okay, I will kick, I will punch, and I will kick and punch the groin and balls. It's just, given the sort of free palette of going, how do you make a bout without using wrestling moves? They just go, I will continually aim for my opponent's
testicles.
Nuts, gooch, buttarm.
Buffman's bridge.
And it is just ball-based abuse.
Yeah, it's BDSM, isn't it?
It slightly is. And I kind of, there's a point halfway through where I think they almost realise that.
Yeah.
And they just go, we have not really given anything here that's very good. No. And then they go, I seem to have concentrated a lot of this on his nuts. And both of them thinking that.
Yeah.
And I suppose the difference is, had it got over massive, then it would have been justifiable.
Mm.
But because it's just silent, that arena, they've had enough already. And watching this bit, even though they're bringing fire to it, because it's all nut-based, once you've seen it once, you're a bit like, oh, are we doing this, are we? There's a guy in the front row wearing a tuxedo T-shirt. As well.
Nice.
I think in 1991 that might not have been ironic.
No, they were cool.
That would have been good. And there's lots of Sting merchandise, but a lot of it is older men holding up like Sting child wife beatery sort of tops. Yes. Little sort of like slips. And they're holding it, and they're clearly children's sizes.
Yeah. Why are you doing that?
It looks a bit like those pictures where they go, the murderer joined in the appeal.
Came back to the scene of the crime.
And here he is, you know. Oh, gosh. Yeah, they do that last bit with the chain between the legs where Sting sort of gets his thing. So the chain's gone through Nikita Koloff's legs and Sting yanks it up and everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because he's wearing a leotard, you have a general idea about where his nuts are stored.
Yes, yeah.
And he does it. And there is no way that Nikita Koloff's nuts are hanging exactly in the middle when he's standing up down. I mean, he would not be able to fucking walk.
No.
They are, you know, so all we're doing here is ball abuse, and it's not even accurate ball abuse. It would have been good if Koloff had just turned around and gone, well, you missed
you
it.
You missed it.
And then Stinger just punted, got him with the toe of his foot.
Exploded them.
Boom. Oh.
Just grabbed them and twisted them as hard as he could.
Yeah. Yeah. Just black vomit coming out of Keith Koloff's nose.
That's a man's soul.
Well, oh, what a link, Pete. Let's watch two men slowly losing their souls.
Yes.
This is Lex Luger versus Barry Windham for the WCW
World
Champions.
Should we do the rest of this in the pub? I'm really thirsty.
On this historic occasion, Lex Luger and Barry Windham have emerged to battle each other in what could be one of the greatest wrestling matches of all time.
The horrible thing that hangs over this as well is the shadow of Ric Flair.
Mm.
So again and again and again, the crowd are chanting Nature Boy.
Yeah.
They're chanting, we want Flair.
Yeah. As the cage comes down, it's a cacophony.
He knows all about the sport. He knows what it takes to be the World Heavyweight Champion, and it should be a tremendous match.
Well, you know, quite obviously, Barry Windham has been a member of many groups.
Oh, and the cage takes a long time to come down. They had to
and
do a lot of
filling.
It didn't
need to be there. It didn't, like, the match did not...
It didn't require it.
It just made it harder to
require,
see. It,
absolutely, you know. they had a real trouble getting the cage down.
Yeah.
So they had to do lots and lots of filling. And in the filler, they end up just saying stuff that buries Barry Windham and really sort of buries WCW to some degree. He may be number two in the program. Shut up, Jim. Sell Barry Windham.
Barry!
Number two in your program, but he's number one in the hearts of many fans that are here in the Baltimore Arena.
A lot of people did think that Ric Flair would be doing a run-in during this.
Really?
And so I think they were excited for the idea. They were going,
right.
the contract thing has been an angle, and what you're going to have is you're going to have a disputed championship or whatever it would be. That didn't happen because it was legitimate. So in a weird way, I think it was even more disappointing when this ended and Ric Flair hadn't come in.
Yeah.
You know, people were like, that match was shit.
Yeah.
You know, this direction is shit.
Yeah.
And the thing that I thought would save it has not happened. Just really poor.
Mm. A great athletic contest, I think Jim Ross calls it at one point.
He says that, but he also says at one point, Lex Luger with a sleeper, and he goes, he's bringing new moves out all the time. Fucking sleeper. He does a DDT and he's like, wow, he's never done that before. And it's like, this is such basic fucking stuff.
Yeah, and look at that DDT. Some new moves from Luger tonight.
You get Jim Ross as well doing his, you know, legitimate sports things.
Mm.
One of the things he mentions is that Luger turned down Naval College, I think. Barry Windham graduated with a 4-point grade average. Oh, you know,
cool.
Well, that's going to make the smashing his head into the cage harder. And he does that. He gets the pin and he's the champion. The crowd do go, yes. And there is that sense that the fans did want to see Lex Luger finally achieve his destiny.
Yeah.
And that this match, had it been handled right, could have been an exciting new era. This is really, I think, you know, for him, this is the horrible thing about that like one of those sort of weird genies that comes out and goes, you may have a wish. It's the monkey's paw, isn't it?
Mm.
That gives you the wish, but there's a sting in the tail. And this is Lex Luger saying, you know, I would love to win, like Sting did, I would like to win the WCW World Championship at Great American Bash.
Yeah.
And the monkey's paw shivered and the fingers gone
you
down.
Didn't know it was a shit belt.
you will win a replica off Barry Windham.
Underwhelming.
Underwhelming. Yeah.
Now dessert.
Yes.
But Tony, right now, we got another cage match.
Looking forward to this one.
Yeah, a mixed gender match. Let's go to Gary Capetta.
We got another cage match.
Oh, good.
Don't ever find yourself saying, we've got another
cage match. We've got another cage because we cannot get the cage up again.
This is Psycho Yuppie Paul E. Dangerously and Arn Anderson versus Rick Steiner and Missy Hyatt. Now, this is the worst main event of all time, but it's also the worst decision made on a major show. So Missy Hyatt does not take part in this match. And the reason for that is because the Maryland Athletic Commission, which governed Baltimore, they strictly forbade male versus female athletic contests.
Yeah.
You could not do it in Maryland.
It sounds like a woman just absolutely bossed an event. We can't have this.
Certainly, WCW knew that they could not deliver that match. They could not have had Missy Hyatt enter the ring for that match. And yet they still went ahead with billing it.
Bucket, right.
Now, there's a funny thing about the placing in the card here, and it seems slightly like they were already expecting the reception to Luger and Wyndham to be a fucking disaster.
Yeah.
They might have said it's because they think Ric Flair's going to come back and we know he's not. That's going to be disappointing. They're going to be waiting. We shouldn't leave it on that. Mm. They may have just sort of thought, well, do you know what? This next match is like for kids. And it's so simple and so stupid, they'll love it. Because do you know what happens? Paulie Dangerously will get punched once. That will be great. Now, people did want to see Missy Hyatt kick Paulie Dangerously up the bottom.
Yes.
It's, you know, a very basic... Yeah. What would be better than watching the New York Motormouth being dominated by a woman? Even a woman.
He's 26.
He's 26. He's fucking insane. Incredible. Instead, what they see is they see a Rick Steiner two-minute match with Arn Anderson before he basically pins Paul Heyman after one move.
Yeah.
It's such a disaster. Arn Anderson is coming down the ring with Paulie Dangerously. Paulie Dangerously is selling it absolutely like you'd expect him to.
Yeah.
And Arn Anderson cannot lift his head. He is... biting his lip, and he's sort of smiling in that way that he's just like, I am stepping into something that I know is just a monumental pile of shit. And it's almost like all the other wrestlers have gone, you're going to do your fucking... Are you seriously doing it?
Are you getting... Why did you say
yes? Oh my God. He's doing it.
Lads! He's going!
Oh my God. Good luck over the next 30 seconds, you fucking prick. It's absolutely... He just looks like he's going, this is the worst thing I've ever been involved in. But thankfully, Pete, here come the hardliners.
Oh.
Dick Slater and Dick Murdoch.
Mm.
Out they come. Now, Paul Heyman in his 20s here. Dick Murdoch, who comes out, he looks like he's in his 60s. He wrestled in a tag team with Dusty Rhodes in the 60s. He, at this point, is in his early 40s.
Wow.
He died aged 49 in 1996, which absolutely, he looks 70.
Yeah.
It's just absolutely mental. Worth talking about him ever so quickly. Dick Murdoch, one of those fantastically gifted natural wrestlers and quite beloved character. He had a sort of good charisma, and his name, he had the nickname Captain Redneck. He is probably the most celebrated of all wrestlers who are strongly believed to have been a member of the Ku Klux Klan.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Bad News Brown said that Dick Murdoch was a member of the Klan in a shoot interview.
Right.
Tito Santana said the same thing in his autobiography. Dusty Rhodes once told the lead writer of SmackDown that Dick Murdoch once took him to a party and he didn't mention beforehand that it was a Ku Klux Klan party. I mean, so, I did read the thing and someone was going, it's like what Diana must Freddie they have Mercury, thought when Dusty Rhodes turned up and they were like, are you a black man in a costume?
I know, yes.
I'm a what there? A blem in a costume? Jive, that is jive. Queer boots, you know? Just a really strange look. And the father of The Rock, Rocky Johnson, said in 2014 that Dick Murdoch was a Klan member.
I mean, it sounds very much like he was, isn't it?
It does, yeah.
I'm going to stick my neck out here.
He said he once knocked him out in a match because he was KKK and he didn't like blacks. He kept kicking me hard and punching me. I said, you hit me one more time, I'm hitting you back. He hit me, so I knocked him out, said Rocky Johnson. Now, I tell you what, Dick, look, let's come to a compromise, okay? The world will move on and you will die in 1996 at the age of 49, okay? We got a deal, bud. We got a deal. They drag out Missy Hyatt that the hardliners are not actually abducting her. They are simply doing the bidding of the Maryland Athletic Commission. And the commentators go, oh, no, basically it's 2-on-1. It was always basically fucking 2-on-1 because your partner was Missy Hyatt.
Yes.
It's crazy. What happens is that Arn does, you know, pretty much his worst match of all time. He gets hit with a Steiner line by Rick Steiner as he comes off the top rope, and he acts like he's been knocked out. And that means Paulie is stuck with Rick Steiner. And that means, of course, that Rick Steiner can do anything he wants, and he can really make this guy pay. And he gives him a clothesline and a power slam, and he pins him.
Yeah.
The crowd are silent, and once again, the guy doing the music does not press the fucking button, and it's just silent. And it's like a load of people all sitting there just going, now, what do I think of all of this?
Gives people time to think about
people
it.
People just looking at each other in the audience across, right, five rows
out?
Away.
Shuffle out, is there a buffet?
I'm just probably going to sit here for a bit.
Pretty tough work here.
Well, it was. It was really above and beyond the call of duty, so to speak.
I'm not, as we take another look,
at our great crowd here in the Baltimore Arena. I'm glad we don't have any more matches here, Tony, because I'm Jim Ross saying so long, everybody.